You are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.
A good example that helps us bridge the gap between myth and fact is an interesting debate that's taking place today and has been taking place for the longest time, especially here in the southern United States and under this Trump administration, because a lot of people are really praising Trump despite the fact that he's a womanizer, a misogynist, a racist, and everything else. The evangelicals seem to love him. The fundamentalists, those who are locked in a particular debate where you teach the children in the public schools on the origins of humanity. Perhaps I should ask all of you if you know where human beings came from. Or better yet, women, do you know where man came from? Basically, the debate centers around whether children should be taught the fundamental interpretation of Genesis, namely that God created Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden. Or did humans evolve from fish first, and then eventually monkeys, over to humanity? Now, of course, in the historical literature, the question has always been posed with gender qualifications. Where did man come from? Never is there anyone asking, where did woman come from? Okay. So I like to share this debate because it's going to prepare us for understanding something about native origins, the Chicano origins. Okay. Now, again, the question has preoccupied man for thousands of years and probably concerned man until the end of his time on Earth, which, if we understand something about climate change, is just around the corner. But about 150 years ago, it was generally accepted that man was created by some deity. So accordingly, Genesis tells us the following. When we take a look at the first creation story in Genesis, chapter 1, verses 24 through 31, the sixth day of creation. Again, when we take a look at Genesis, that's oral history. Genesis is religion, it's mythological. So you can believe it with regards to your faith, or you can say, well, it's not literally true. But nonetheless, there is the story of Genesis. And if you want to know who's speaking in this, all right, it is Abraham. Abraham is sharing the story. Abraham has left the city of Ur, and the city of Ur is in Mesopotamia, which is present-day Iraq. And so Abraham is sharing this story, that on the sixth day of creation, God has created the universe, God has created the earth, God has created the plants and the animals. And so what God is going to do is he's going to get some mud, mix it with clay and earth, and he's going to blow life into man and woman. That's the first story of creation. Man and woman are created together. Then in chapter 2, there's a different story. Verses 1 through 25, there's a different version. That after the seventh day, God was very jealous, because he's a very jealous God, and he wanted to make sure that Adam, he was very concerned about him because he was living naked without shame in the Garden of Eden, and he didn't have somebody to play with. Yeah. And so God, being the great anesthesiologist that he was, he puts Adam to sleep and pulls a rib from Adam and then mixes it with clay and earth and blows life into his playmate, which is Eve. Now, I'm not going to get involved in all the other different kinds of stories, but that's the second story. So these are stories. They're really good stories with regards to understanding creation. And this creation of humanity occurs in the Middle East, in Iraq, where it seems that everyone is bombing Iraq. The origins of the religions. But this fundamental interpretation satisfied Western civilization throughout the ages until in the 1850s, a revolutionary thinker named Charles Darwin brought forth a theory that astounded the world and had caused men to at least consider in a rational manner the concept of natural selection. So Darwin developed a theory that arrived at the conclusion that man descended from some lowly form. So many Christians considered Darwin a heretic, and many Christians considered his work an affront to the biblical portrayal of creation. And Darwin admitted that his theory would be distasteful to many, but he vehemently argued that biologically speaking, there was no doubt man evolved from some primitive form of life. Now, I like this particular picture because it shows us where man is headed. Now, that's because man doesn't follow his reason, he follows his passion. And right now, everybody is so passionate in terms of those who believe in the fundamental interpretation of the Bible are thinking that Trump is the Savior in his sinful ways. But really what Trump represents is passion, which is greed and self-interest and self-righteousness. And I think that's a classic evolutionary story. But Darwin does not necessarily propose that man descended from monkeys. It's going to take archaeologists in the 20th century to make the link. Now, Darwin did consider some redeeming qualities from such an evolutionary process. As he stated in his research, "For my own part, I would soon be descended from that heroic little monkey who braved his dreaded enemy in order to save the life of his keeper, or from that old baboon who descended from the mountains, carried away in triumph his young comrade from a crowd of astonished dogs, as from the savage who delights to torture his enemies, offers up his bloody sacrifices, practices infanticide without remorse, and treats his wives like slaves, knows no decency, and is haunted by the grossest superstition." So Darwin had no use for misogyny. Darwin had no use for war. Darwin had no use for murder. And so, of course, when I stopped to think about it, I'm sure that if the monkey had anything to say in the matter, he would prefer not being too closely associated with humans. Because up until environmental loss and climate change, there was no record of simians killing one of their own kind for a thrill. Monkeys don't desert or abuse their offspring. They don't hoard, they don't steal, they don't fence in property, they don't participate in wars. They don't discriminate against each other because of the appearance of color. So if man did descend from some lowly form, undoubtedly the monkeys would strongly say, "Not from us." So think about it. But anyway, Darwin gave us the biological explanation. But archaeological discoveries provided perhaps a conclusive evidence of quote-unquote man's descent from apes. And that was Dr. Louis Leakey's quest to find the origins of man, and to this date, fossil finds and the use of sophisticated dating methods give us a generalized periodized scheme. First, there's Homo habilis. Australopithecus. Then from Australopithecus comes Homo habilis. Then from Homo habilis comes Homo erectus. Men not quite resembling modern men. Men who definitely looked like monkeys but acted like men. And I think women, you can understand, especially with regards to gender and misogyny, that these men are still around. But these monkey men are not anatomically modern human beings like us. They are not Homo sapiens sapiens. They are not Homo sapien sapiens. What makes us human is very important. What makes us human is that we can move and look behind us. It's the hip that makes us human. The monkey people didn't have hips. That's why they have to look behind themselves. What makes us human is that we are anatomically modern. That's most important. Now, very important is that these monkey people, these almost close humans, they are from a long time. The facts are there. They are there in Africa, Asia, Middle East, Europe, and Australia. Or all of those living in the Eastern Hemisphere. These monkey men roamed the other side of the world, and they're given specific names for the area that they roamed and the time that they survived. So everybody has heard of, again, Australopithecus, Homo habilis, Homo erectus. Then there's the near men, Homo sapiens, but they are not anatomically modern like us. They're still monkey people. The Neanderthal, the Cro-Magnon, the Java, the Peking man. And since most of the artifacts found in prehistoric sites are made of stone, the period of history is commonly known as the Stone Age. And I think the rock and roll band is still with us, the Rolling Stones. They don't seem to leave. Now, in their studies, experts have noted gradual changes in prehistoric cultures, and as a result, they often divide this Stone Age into three stages, the Paleolithic, the Mesolithic, and the Neolithic. Okay, but what's going to happen is, of course, there's more research and modern technology. There's going to be rich finds. In fact, it starts in 1974 with Dr. Donald C. Johansson in Case Western Reserve University in the Cleveland Museum of Natural History. His expedition colleagues are going to discover a 3-million-year-old skeleton. And lo and behold, he's going to name the skeleton Lucy. He's going to name her. And the skeleton moved the time back even further. And of course, Lucy threw a monkey wrench into the question of, quote unquote, man's descent. How's that for some humor? But Lucy and her kind inhabited an ancient Ethiopian lakeshore. Lucy walked upright and foraged for food. But these were members not of the genus Homo sapiens. These bones resembled monkeys, not humans. So when we understand the paradise scheme with regards to science and the fact that there are these pre-Homo sapiens sapien types, Homo habilis, the first clear ancestor on man's lineage, appeared in Africa. Approximately 1 million years ago, Homo erectus, more advanced form, appears in Asia, Africa, Europe. Then there's a whole question of Australia. And about 180,000 years ago, near men, they're called Neanderthal, they're called Cro-Magnon, they dominated the Middle East and the connecting continents. And then finally, fully modern man, our direct ancestors. Well, they appear in the Middle East and Europe sometime between 35 to 38,000 years ago. But there's still debates as to when anatomically modern human beings appear. Don't know when. There is some to debate as whether the Cro-Magnon is a modern man. And the Cro-Magnonists insist that the Neanderthalists are not modern. So even the Cro-Magnonists and the Neanderthalists, you ought to see them go after each other because they debate. But I went and asked the Neanderthalists and the Cro-Magnonists, you guys, you're sharing with us that they're modern humans, but you know that they're not. They're not modern humans. And the Cro-Magnonists insist, and this is one of the reasons why science just automatically assumes that we are part of the monkey people. And so everybody thinks, oh, well, we're all part of the monkey people. Some claim we wouldn't be able to distinguish a Cro-Magnon if they were walking around today. Despite those commercials for that insurance. But no, I've been to New York. I've been to Los Angeles. I think they're still around us. I've seen them. they're everywhere. But again, what makes us human, what makes us unique is that we have hips, is that we can move, is that we can look behind us, look around, look and do this, and we can get involved with the myth of pleasure. Say that myth of pleasure is so awesome. But the debatable question of man's evolution is going to send religious leaders into a quandary. Are our ancestors humans or were they monkeys? What in heaven was God doing? So the Roman Catholic Church was stuck between a rock and a hard place. And the church, just as much as it didn't believe Copernicus's theory of the world being round until Columbus and Magellan's adventures proved otherwise, likewise, the church, by a faith position, is going to uncomfortably come to accept the archaeological evidence. At some point in time, between the Neanderthal and Cro-Magnon, and then the arrival of the human, at some point in time, the infusion of a human soul occurred. And this is how the church, the Catholic Church, uncomfortably came to accept the archaeological evidence. It was rigorously guided by the principle that when you look at Genesis, that at some point in time, the infusion of a human soul occurred. However, there's the fundamentalists of the Bible Belt. They're still in a quandary over the literal interpretation of Genesis. The Christian Coalition today, they don't like the idea of science. They talk about intelligent design. Now, why do I enter into a debate over the use of physical evidence and oral interpretation? Whether it be archaeological finds, facts, evolution, whether it be oral history, myth, and Genesis. It's to emphasize the point that we are daily confronted with issues that stem from these important controversies. We are continuously called to resolve dilemmas stemming from the use of physical evidence and the spoken word. Whether you be a lawyer or a judge that's dealing with a case, whether you be a Native American asking a museum to return their ancestral remains for a reburial, whether you be a doctor relying on scientific medicine, or a curandera using home remedies for curing, whether you be a professor defending a thesis, or whether you be Fraga student trying to figure out what the hell is Fraga talking about? The origins of human beings. But you see, discussing these debates prepares us for the complicated task of answering the most important question of the Western Hemisphere. Where did native peoples come from? Or to put it in a misnomeric language, where did Indian people come from? Now, although confusion and chaos exist concerning the origins of man himself, utter controversy enters the scene when native peoples discover Columbus. Now, we know that the term Indian came from Columbus when he mistakenly thought he reached India. And this misconception is still with us to this day. Furthermore, people are still intrigued today as they were over 500 years ago on the origins of this quaint and curious people, mascots notwithstanding. Now, the debates of the origins of the people from the Western Hemisphere is controversial. The debates on the origins of the people from the Western Hemisphere is very problematic. And the source of confusion can be traced to identity and worldview. And thanks to anthropologists, archaeologists, social scientists, this confusion is elevated to some kind of mystical explanation or some kind of theosophical interpretation. One of the major concepts as to how the native peoples came to be in the Western Hemisphere proposes that they were not native to this area, but rather they were immigrants. But before we turn to that common archaeological explanation and the native peoples' interpretation, I want to share with you some other popular theories. Just so that you can recognize that there's all kinds of theories out there as to where the native peoples came from. Now, one of the things I put up, there's Star Trek and Avatar, and then there's Visitations in Pangaea. But in the 1970s, at the height of the drug, sex, and rock and roll era, there was a book that was written by this anthropologist named Eric von Daniken called Chariots of the Gods, and it presented some startling facts, and it constructed a hypothesis of visitors from space who build complex civilizations here on Earth. And on the plain of Nazca in Peru are some strange geometrically drawn lines in the earth which baffle many scientists. And some archaeologists say were the Inca roads. However, they go nowhere in particular. They don't connect any known points of inhabitation. So why were they constructed? But according to von Däniken, they were laid out in an astronomical plan, and they represent an ancient airfield where people from outer space needed them to land the crafts in which they arrived. And von Däniken at that time encountered some great stone carvings, an astronomical calendar, and a recording of a legend in which a woman fell from the stars in a golden spaceship. And so this supported his theory. In the 1970s, bookstores abounded with publications concerning outer space visitors. Now, supposedly, native peoples didn't have the wherewithal to build their own civilizations, but they needed the help of space visitors to come down. Now, this is a nice story. This theory proved very favorable, especially to the Star Trek generation. And since then, we've had all kinds of people going everywhere trying to find their out-of-body experiences in some particular vortexes or some particular places in the earth that have this true mysterious power. And everyone's involved in some kind of avatar, in some kind of creating some kind of experience. Another popular and intriguing theory which attracted a lot of attention is that native peoples are the descendants of a great civilization that occupied the continent of Atlantis. And of course, in Atlantis, this is the great mound building theory that is about what happened over here. The Atlanteans, the lost continent, was the cradle of civilization. It was the Garden of Eden, the Gardens of Hesperides, the Elysian Fields, all the ideal places of ancient history. Its trade routes reach around the globe. And the colonies from Atlantis are going to be established everywhere. And as Atlantis sank, some of these colonies remained as Native American groups in North and South America. And this accounts for similarities between some of the attributes of Native American cultures and those of other parts of the world. So by the fact that the Native American cultures were cut off from the civilizations of the world, they declined and they became quote-unquote primitive cultures founded by Europeans at the close of the 15th century. It's a nice, neat story. And then what's so fascinating in oral tradition, there's many theories concerning pre-Columbian visitations. There's many people who already have laid claim to them coming to these shores by people from all over the world, the old world. So when you take a look at oral tradition, the Hebrews, they have stories of them being in North Carolina, South Carolina. The Phoenicians, stories of being along the Atlantic coast. Basques, Celts, Chinese, Vikings, Scotch, Irish, Welsh. All of them have fascinating stories of arriving in this part of the world before Columbus. And one of the most sophisticated and one of the most controversial of the stories is the one that is espoused and propagated by Mormons. And the Mormon doctrine is very important because the Mormons today believe that that they are the descendants of the great races of Mesopotamia. Of the middle continent. And one way for Native peoples to save themselves is to become Mormon. Now, I don't want to get involved in the controversy over the Mormon religion, but nonetheless, Mormon religion has some of the most fascinating stories of that experience. So those are the visitations. And then anyone who has witnessed the effects of an earthquake or a volcanic eruption can have little doubt that the earth contains some very powerful forces. They also realize that these forces, if unleashed in their total potential, can drastically change the face of the earth. So you cannot imagine. Geologists wonder what could be or has been accomplished by the long-continued release of energy from the earth, hence the shifting continents theory and Pangaea. Many scientists espouse the idea that the continents were once separated, that the continents that are now separated were once in contact, that rather than the land masses being divided by oceans, they were once all in the same hemisphere. And the theory is that North America was attached to the west coast, if you take a look at this particular map, of Europe, I don't know if you have it, but South America to the coast of Africa and northwestern Australia to the east coast of India, the Antarctica to the southwest of Africa and southeast of Australia. So it's possible that the land areas of the Earth were once united, and at some time they drifted apart in the past. So it also stands to reason that the distant ancestors who eventually evolved into man could also have inhabited the same land areas. And so the native peoples simply drifted into this geographic location known as the Western Hemisphere. Okay. So those are all the different theories. Now let's turn to the archaeological record to answer the question where native peoples come from. Now, the archaeological record is very controversial. And as I shared with you, it's chaotic. There's so many debates as to how native peoples came. It's just incredible. They rely on different techniques. There's morphology, blood typing, skull analysis, hieroglyphs, and then radiocarbon dating techniques or carbonating techniques. So archaeologists presume that the native population of the Western Hemisphere came across the Bering Strait some time ago. And this is what is known, and native peoples refer to as the Bering Strait theory. The early view of the 20th century was that they came to the Americas about 10,000 years ago. Okay. However, with innovations in modern equipment and the continuing desecration of indigenous burial sites, that the time the people entered this hemisphere is pushed back even further. So if you were to open up U.S. history textbooks, in 1900, if you were going to college and you read a U.S. history textbook, it would say that Native peoples arrived in the Western Hemisphere about 10,000 years ago. But in the 1930s, it was pushed back to 30,000. In the 1950s, if you read the U.S. the history textbooks, it's to 40,000. In the early 1980s, it reached the 70,000 mark. So there's always been debates as to when the native peoples arrived in the Western Hemisphere. Now, why is the Bering Strait popular? It can be attributed to several reasons. One, it presents a very simple and uncomplicated process of these wandering nomads stumbling along after their quarry. And most importantly, it provides a necessary link to the pre-Homo sapien types that roam the other side of the world. Because on the other side of the world, there are the pre-Homo sapien types. There are those monkey people who are part of the other side of the world. And it satisfies the claims that native peoples are not a separate race of people. The native peoples are part of what is known as the Mongolian or the Mongoloid tradition. And you have to remember that science, for the longest time, only recognized three polygynous types of groups or three racialized groups. One was white, known as Caucasoid. One was black, known as Negroid. The other was Asian, known as Mongoloid. And then in the 1980s, they found a fourth direction known as Australoid. But in the Western Hemisphere, there's no Indianoids. Okay, so that's one of the reasons why the Bering Strait is so popular, is that native peoples were once Asians. So who knows? Maybe Indian people from India did come across the Bering Strait, and they eventually arrived in Haiti, where Columbus eventually encountered them. So maybe Columbus wasn't wrong. Maybe he did reach and met Indians. But it allows the proponents, the Bering Strait allows the proponents to pursue the theory without the issue becoming clouded by the facts. Okay? So in this quest to discover where Indians came from, archaeologists, I think, are confronted with a serious dilemma, because no one has ever found Cro-Magnon or Neanderthal bones in the New World. And this is the reason why people insist that evolution is so important. That's why Nacho Libre, his friend, what's his name, says, I don't believe in God, I believe in science. And again, evolution says that we came from monkeys. But those monkeys are not anatomically modern like us. They are not anatomically modern human beings. And so here in the Western Hemisphere, none of those monkey bones are found in the Western Hemisphere. The only bones that are uncovered are those of anatomically modern human beings. But it is within this evolutionary perspective that modern society has come to accept the Bering Strait theory, which is fine. There is a movement of population that comes across because peoples are constantly moving and migrating. Migration is an important feature of the human experience. People are constantly moving. But it's within this evolutionary perspective that modern society has come to accept it. So science in the written word says that native peoples came across from Asia. And before that, they were monkeys. And before that, they were fish. And then meanwhile, in the Judeo-Christian tradition, it presupposes through the Mormon expression that native peoples are the lost tribe of Israel. Okay? So now let's go to native peoples. The links to the pre-Homo sapien types are very important. And what I put up here, the Wisconsin Glacial Stage and Land Bridge, yes, the Wisconsin Glacial Stage and Land Bridge is very important because there is a land bridge that occurs, but they occur in different time in the past. One from 120,000 to 130,000, and then from 90,000 years ago to about 70,000 years, and then definitely between 10 and 14,000 years ago. There's the Wisconsin Glacial Stage and Land Bridge, where the ice expands and then recedes, every 10,000 years, we do see a land bridge. So with regards to the movements of populations, which way they were going, well, that's open to debate. Who knows about that? Yeah. And again, this is the significance of interpreting the material is that you do have the archaeological evidence, but now what about the oral tradition and the word? So when we take a look at native populations, what do native peoples tell us about their creation? And in this particular Unit 1, I ask you students to go in and take a look at some of the creation stories, where you're going to be kind of taking a look at and recognize certain things about those creation stories. But I'm going to be in the next segment. I want you to listen to the next segment before you do that assignment, because I'm going to talk about and expand more on what environmental religions are all about. But it is through oral tradition that native peoples define for themselves what truth and untruth is. When we take a look at the prose, the poetry, and origin stories of native oral tradition, it reveals that native peoples come from the earth and that they have always been human. Plus, they are following the religious prescriptions handed down to them from Creator, however so defined. And when you take a look at these creation stories, they're always rooted in the environment. They're always rooted in their relationship to plants, in their relationship to animals, to the creatures, to the creepers, to the crawlers, to the winged ones. So according to Native people's history, according to Native people's traditions, their ancestors are not the Asians, they're not the lost tribe of Israel, they're not monkeys or fish. They didn't come across the Bering Strait. If you remember Nora Naranjo Morse, she believes her people emerged. And that's how she believes. When you translate the different indigenous nations' names to any European language, you get a common denominator for all of them. They are caretakers of the earth. Native religions throughout the Western hemispheres have tremendous commonalities. Now, first and foremost, I want to get away from this notion of gods, because I don't believe in all of these gods. People continuously argue that native religions are polytheistic or having many gods rather than monotheistic or having one god. See, monotheistic religion, or those who profess the Judeo-Christian Islamic tradition, consists of one god, intimately present in every creature, plant, animal, and human, and that everything remains sustained in creation. So this is important. Let's understand that. But let's go and appreciate.